And joining us live in the studio to discuss this issue are M.M. Nwogogo. She is a life coach, and also Dr. Tuyi Mebawodu. Thank you for joining me, M.M. And Dr. Tuyi, thanks for staying with us still. Yeah, now, let me ask you this. Do we have the exact statistics of rapes that happens on the daily in our country, Nigeria?
I think we might, but okay. I'm not very sure of the numbers. Yeah. We should.
Dr. Tuyi.
Again, the statistics is actually submerged. It's like an iceberg phenomenon.
Yeah.
You see quite few people, you know, being bold enough to come ahead and say, okay, yes, a rape. Mm-hmm. But even at that, we still get as much as, you know, close to 20%, you know, of young women of that reproductive age being raped, even from the statistics we have.
Are we still in denial of the fact that rape occurs on the daily in our country, and why there seems to be so much a cultural shame around, for the victims especially, not the perpetrators? How do we begin to address this?
I think the only way we can address it, I was just watching in the news, I feel we need a lot of awareness. We need a lot of people talking about it, leaders in the media. I think the radio station, the TV station, talk about it as often as we can. Tell people it's not your fault. If you're raped, report to this number, call this company. So once we make it a duty, everyone takes it as a big deal, that report rape, don't keep it to yourself. You know, and then we make people who go through rape not to feel the stigmatization. That's the first thing we're going to do. Hmm.
And let's come to the psychological effect, the trauma that these victims go through of being raped. Dr. Tuyi, you want to help us in that?
Huge one, huge trauma. It's quite traumatic. Yeah. Apart from the fact that there's actually a violation or devaluation of the woman, there's violation, there's devaluation of the young lady who's probably innocent and trusted the rapist to that extent. You know, the psychological trauma stays with the lady for quite a long time. And unfortunately, we don't have sufficient psychologists to counsel and return the mood back. You know, secondly, rapes come with a lot of violence. It comes with a lot of diseases in addition. And then the woman's ability to trust and relate as even, you know, a married person may be challenged. You know, he looks at everybody from that perspective. It's made worse by the fact that even diagnosis is complex and difficult. To prove rape cases is not as easy as we may think. Mm. Except when you have some obvious cults and terror and all those evidence of violence. But the lag time between occurrence and reportage is usually long. And then, you know our legal system is quite protracted, tortuous, and confusing. So now, even as a parent, do you want this girl who has been pushed through this kind of terrible situation, or this young boy who has been pushed through this kind of terrible situation, to now be coming to court, be persuaded of reporting and all those things? You know, that confidentiality must be able to be provided for people to be confident that, okay, wait a minute, I can now come out to you.
Okay, now there seems to be a lot of secrecy that shrouds when someone is raped. Like in the documentary that was aired, the girl said she was for a long time, she didn't want to tell anybody, she didn't know how to tell anybody. And that's because of the way society perceives the rape victim. We blame the rape victim. Why did you go there? Why did you wear that?
Exactly.
I mean, it must be your fault.
That's
and then we shame the victim and the perpetrator goes free. That narrative, how do we begin to change that narrative? The perpetrator must also be made to face the consequences of his action. What do you suggest is the best solution to that? Because of this, many people who are being raped on the daily don't see the need to speak out.
I would say, we know we have communities, we have churches, we have schools. Imagine that we have awareness from the very grassroots level. Yes. We have them in the neighborhood in different languages. We have them posted on the wall saying not to rape, report rape cases. It's not your fault. Do not allow stigmatization to stop you from reporting. So if we do a lot of awareness, just like when we're running for, when we have election in Nigeria, so much talk about who to vote for.
Yeah.
Take rape, you know, the same way. With awareness, people will come out boldly.
Dr. Tuyi, let's change the narrative on the perpetrator.
In addition, that's what I wanted to actually.
Yes.
Now, we must be able to be bold enough to name the perpetrator. In fact, as much as we're protecting the victim, we must be able to expose the perpetrator. In fact, in some instances, it might even be necessary that if you have It's not because again there's a challenge of that law that okay you have to be guilty before you can
exactly.
pronounce.
That's another
you have thing. To you know you have to go through court and yes. say okay before you can be pronounced guilty. But let's also point out that this person is a suspect of rape.
Exactly.
Go and report to police. Let the CDA in your community where you are living.
True.
Let the CDA know that
true.
you are even if you are you know undergoing trial for rape. Let the community know. Let the police know. Let the CDA know. So that shaming can help a lot to prevent people from, you know. And then even in terms of, you know, employment, in terms of employment and work placement, if you are a rapist, you must be able to declare that I'm undergoing trial for declare it. Let us put the weight. Let us put the shame on those people that, you know, partook.
On the rapist.
Yeah, on the rapist.
Yeah. Yeah. And in this particular documentary, the victim was actually a 16-year-old. She was underage. And this seems to be an everyday scenario. We have cases of 2-year-old, 4-year-old child being raped. What is society not paying attention to critically?
I also think that for Africans, Nigeria, a lot of people are still uncomfortable talking about sex. Educating young people. So I think from 3 years old in Nigeria, you should educate your kids, even from 2, with you have domestic workers who also rape children, you have relatives. So because of what is going on in the society and the times have changed, kids are more aware, they're exposed. Some parents allow their kids to handle their phone. So you need a lot of sex education at an early age, because some of these young ladies, you'd be amazed that their moms, even their guardians, don't talk about sex with them. They don't expect that they're going to experience anything like that. And then when that happens, they fall a victim.
Yes.
So, and then the trust system, oh, this is my uncle, you know, and all of that. So now we train kids, we tell them, this is not your uncle, this is Mr.
Yes.
So you're able to differentiate your relationship with whoever comes into the house. And then I have a rule where I tell my staff, I said, if I'm not at home, my siblings who are males, my male siblings are not allowed to come in. And even for female as well, I have a friend who told me that a grown woman, her cousin raped her son when he was 5 years old.
Dr. Tui, what is the first thing to do when a rape case is reported and a person is identified medically?
Again, first and foremost, I'm sure there are centers and hot numbers, you know, nobody that you can call, you know, imagine somebody that can be called to really move in quickly and see what can be done. Of course, the first thing is actually to report to that center or get to the hospital, call police in. I think that the hospital is the first place you should go, actually. So when you get to the hospital, call police, because the evidence must be preserved,
exactly.
You know, so because by the time you are going to police and coming back, you might have lost some of those clear-cut evidence. So get to an hospital, let them help you call the emergency number, then involve police. Get all your evidence as much as possible. And then, you know, that I think that's the starting point.
All right.
You know, so
Dr. Tuyi Mebawondu, thank you very much for your contribution. And also MM Uwogugu, life coach, thank you for joining us this morning.
You're welcome.